thank you so much for joining us today and buying this cheesesteak kit. I am very, very excited to, one, eat a cheesesteak. I don't know about you guys. One of my favorite sandwiches out there in this world right now. And my name is Chef Connie. I will be your chef instructor. And I also have DJ Joey Z here with me as well. He's going to be making sure we got those sound effects. We got that music. If you guys were jamming earlier, that was your boy right there, of course. He's a legend. We all know him. We all love him. And just out of curiosity, I know some of us have taken a truffle shuffle class before, but give me a thumbs up if you are a truffle shuffle out there. Give me some thumbs out there. Yes! Oh my God, Kathleen, yes. Hi, everybody. So I am very honored to lead this voyage to our cheesesteak victory here. And so a little bit about the Philly cheesesteak. Diane is actually in Philadelphia. And so you know Gino and Pat's, of course, obviously. And so I myself, born and raised in Southern California, but I spent a lot of time in my early 20s on the East Coast. And every Christmas, I would go to Marlton, New Jersey. And Marlton, New Jersey is the south tip of New Jersey, and it's about a 45, 30-minute drive to Philadelphia. And so I myself would indulge in a Philly cheesesteak every Christmas. So for me, this is sort of a recipe that I love, and I also am obsessed with sandwiches. And so for me, this is a great way to sort of add a little bit of California ingredients to a classic Philadelphia sandwich, okay? And so a lot of people ask me, it's labeled California cheesesteak, and everyone says, what, is there avocado in it? And even though that joke is hilarious and would be pretty good, it does not. I know. It's just California ingredients making a modern classic, okay? And so, first things first, just some ground rules for these virtual experiences. You guys know keeping that video on is essential. Joey Z loves to see everyone chopping it up, stirring it up, dancing. And keeping that mute on as much as possible is just super helpful. But we are all here to answer any of your culinary questions, of course. And so if you guys have any questions about this recipe or just cooking knowledge in general, that is literally what we chefs here at Truffle Shuffle are paid to do and love to do truly. And so if you guys could do me a favor, and just to get sort of that questionnaire ready to go, we like to use that chat bar feature to ask any questions. And so I'm gonna ask you guys a question and ask where you guys are in the world. And so pop open that chat bar and just type in what city you are representing this lovely Monday, all right? I know Diane is in Philadelphia, rocking it hard out there, love it. Oh yeah, Jacqueline in the Richmond, Virginia, amazing, love that. Yeah, people talking away. We are in Oakland, California. We're having a gorgeous sunny day here in California, I must say. Oh, we got the Wagners in Lake Tahoe. Yes. Ah, I'm sure it's gorgeous. Super jealous. I should come visit. Awesome. All right, so we're all over the place. Yeah, I will. I'll do it. I promise. And so first things first, the only way we like to start any of our Truffle Shuffle experiences is with a beverage. And so if you guys want to make a cocktail on a Monday, give me a thumbs up. You guys ready to do this? Everyone want a cocktail? Yes. Oh, my God. Everyone's giving me some sugar there. I love that. And so we're just going to ease into this recipe. And so the only thing you need out of your kit right now is that Paloma mixer. Okay, so grab that Paloma mixer. It looks just like that. Gorgeous. And we're going to make this extra fancy because we're super fancy here at Truffle Shuffle. And so go ahead and grab this little baggie right here. This is a Bolognese truffle salt. All right, looks just like that. Ooh, la, 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 la. And to make a beautiful salted rim cocktail, super helpful to grab yourself either two small plates or two small bowls, okay? Either one. Two small plates, two small bowls. And this mixer is enough for two cocktails, okay? Two beverages total. So go ahead and I'm going to for sure make one for Joey Z.
Oh, yeah.
Our boy over here. And one for myself. But you can make one for now, one for now, one for later. One giant cocktail or one for yourself, one for a friend. Okay, totally up to you. But just keep in mind this is enough for two beverages total. And so whenever you have citrus juice in your mixer, it's always a good idea to shake it, okay? So grab that holy cocktail shaker or a mason jar with a lid or a protein bottle, Tupperware, anything with a fastened lid, you can MacGyver your way through this, okay? And then if you are choosing to indulge on a Monday, like myself, a traditional Paloma is made with tequila, okay? That is a traditional Paloma from Mexico, right? But if you like gin or vodka, mezcal, whiskey, it all works. It's all very universal. It'll make it happen, okay? And so what I'm going to do is open up that cocktail mixer, and I'm going to splash about 2 tablespoons on that first plate. And then that second plate, I'm going to go ahead and just remove that Bolognese truffle salt out of the bag and onto that plate. So that way I have this surface area for my cocktail rims, and I can get my fingers on and in that salt when I need to. Awesome. All right, so here's the move with that salted rim. Run the rim of that glass through that plate full of mixer. And then once you've done that, tap it in the salt. Voila. Look at it. Beautiful. You can do the same technique with sugar. You can do the same technique with something salty, right? If you like Bloody Marys too, a little tamarind paste, a little tahini. Gorgeous. Okay, so lots you can do with that. Once I have my vessel, I'm going to go ahead and grab my cocktail shaker. And any mixer I have on that plate, do not waste that. That is good stuff. Pour that baby right into your cocktail shaker. I'm going to go ahead and remove that salt to the side. Let it dry out. I'm going all in with that mixer. Happy Monday, everybody. And then we like to suggest 2 ounces of alcohol per cocktail. And since this is 2 cocktails, we're going to go ahead and do 4 total, okay? So 2 for myself. Uh-oh. And a very big happy Monday 2 for DJ Joey Z. You're worth it, buddy. Yes. All right. So choose your own adventure. But for this entire bottle of mixer, it is 4 ounces of alcohol as a baseline. Okay. Baseline. All right. Whenever you shake a cocktail, please add a little bit of ice to your glasses and a little bit of ice to your shaker. All right, so once you have all this concoction ready, mixer, ice, liqueur, go ahead, get those lids on, and we're going to shake it for about 30 seconds, all right? Yes. The Wagners have been shaking it for a while. We see you, the Wagners. You nailed it. Diane shaking it up. Yes, cheers out there. Oh,
Jacqueline's got the towel, too.
Oh, yes. Jacqueline, safety first. I think
that's professional.
Yes.
Jacqueline, crushing it.
Give me 5 more seconds here. 3, 2, and 1. Nicely done, everybody. Woo! We're already burning calories. All right, so when you shake a cocktail that has citrus in it, you'll notice that as you pour it out, you're gonna have some beautiful effervescence, right? That beautiful natural reaction where the bubbles and, or the citrus and the ice make some beautiful bubbles here. And so I'm gonna go ahead and hand one over to DJ Joey Z when you're ready. Right behind you, my friend. And if everyone can do me a favor, I would love to cheers you beautiful human beings, and I would love to cheers to cheesesteaks. So hold up your glasses, and on the count of 3, we're gonna not only unmute, we're gonna break all the rules, we're gonna unmute, and we'll go ahead and cheers to each other, all right? 3, 2, 1, cheers!
Cheers, everyone!
Cheers, Cam! Yes! Salud! Yum. All right, so these citrus forward cocktails, or even mocktails, right? These beverages make you nice and hungry, right? Get your palate nice and cleansed. The salt draws out the saliva, gets you good and hungry, okay? And so as we're enjoying these delicious beverages, I'm gonna start talking about this recipe. And so first things first, I'm gonna go ahead and talk about our equipment, right? Our mise en place. Mise en place, as you know, especially being truffle shufflers, literally translates from French, everything in this place. And so if you haven't done that quick scavenger hunt, I'm just gonna go ahead and go through those pieces of equipment while we enjoy that beverage, right? And so for this, we can go ahead and grab that cutting board. Beautiful. And then you're also going to need a chef's knife, okay? Awesome, so grab that chef's knife. And the Wagners are asking, can we get the mixer recipe? And so in your recipe card, there should be a Paloma mixer recipe, and that one should have the ratios, okay? So that's gonna have the ratios right there. So if you do wanna recreate this Paloma, you 100% can. And I will say, My favorite grapefruit juice to buy is that Ottawa grapefruit. I know. Or Viola, right? Vala has a really great grapefruit base. And so agave syrup is pretty easy to find. Grapefruit, a little lemon juice, and you're good to go. Awesome. Let me see. Does this recipe not have that ratio? I feel like it does. Ah! Oh, it just tells you the ingredients, but not the ratios. The Wagner's I lied straight to your face. Okay, so here we go. So a Paloma recipe is traditionally 2 parts grapefruit to a 0.5 part simple syrup. How you make agave syrup is very simple. Simple syrup. In general, we can do a little, is everyone cool if I do a quick cocktail nerdiness right now? Is everyone cool with that? Okay, so here we go. So, palomas, in traditional Mexican, well, I've been to Mexico multiple times, is grapefruit with a splash of simple syrup and tequila, okay? So, when you make simple syrup, it is 1 part sugar, 1 part water. So, take that, right? And so, for this paloma mixer right here, in that bottle to make 2 drinks, you would need 1 cup of grapefruit juice, 1/4 cup of lemon juice, and then 1/4 cup of agave simple syrup. Chef Joey Z, the extraordinaire that he is also typing this in. And to make agave simple syrup, if you are making a big batch, you always make more than you need, but a very simple batch of agave simple syrup is 1 cup sugar, 1 cup water, 4 tablespoons of agave honey, okay? And so you take all those things and you make a mixer out of it. Luckily, when you make that mixer, there's so much sugar in it that you can make a big batch of it and it'll probably last you about 2 to 3 weeks, right? Sugar is a natural preserver. And so if you guys want to make a big batch of it, whenever I do catering events, I make a big batch, a big ball jar of it. And then you just do 2 ounces of tequila per cup of mixer. Easy peasy. Awesome. All right, next time you guys make it, definitely send me a pic. I want to see how these beautiful palomas turn out. Awesome. And I do truly suggest that buying grapefruit juice is a little bit of a cheat, but it's kind of worth it. But if you like to squeeze your own citrus, squeezing fresh citrus will always make your cocktails better, no matter what, legitimately. So there we go. Sorry, that was my nerdy cocktail hour. Amazing. All right, so we're for sure gonna need that cutting board and that chef's knife. And then the only thing we will need on our stove today is either a large saute pan or a cast iron pan, okay? So if you have that cast iron pan that you love, that you've taken care of, that's nice and seasoned, go ahead, hold that cast iron pan. This is my favorite game to play. If you have a cast iron pan or whatever large saute pan you decided to use today, hold that up. Joey Z loves to see what everyone's rocking today. Oh my God, look at these seasoned pans. Oh. Chefs who take care of your equipment. Beautiful.
What is that?
Oh,
the Wagner.
Oh, we got the grill pan. There we go. Nice. That's the best part about this recipe, and if you guys have taken a recipe with me as well, you know that I like to do everything in one pan. So we're just gonna need that solid cast iron or large saute pan. But we are also gonna be making our own cheese whiz this beautiful Monday. So go ahead and grab yourself a small sauce pot and either grab yourself the lid that fits that sauce pot. But here's something my dad used to do. If you don't have a lid that works, you can always grab a bowl or a small plate so that when we make the cheese sauce in a few moments, we can let it melt evenly, okay? So small sauce pot with a lid or a plate that fits. Easy. And that's all we're gonna need on our stoves, that's it. But out of our smallwares drawer, right, out of our tools, there we go, nice lid, the Wagner's over there. We're going to need ourselves a whisk, all right? We're going to be whisking up that cheese, making that cheese whiz from scratch. We're going to be needing a wooden spoon. We're going to be mixing it up over here. And this is not necessary, but a ladle is going to help us get that cheese from the pan onto our cheese stick. So if you have a ladle, yeah, doesn't matter what size. There we go. Oh my God, over at Jacqueline's house, we got a sous chef helping us out with that equipment. Nicely done, chef. Oh my God, you are Beautiful. Look at you, little baby boy. Oh my god. He's like, this wooden spoon tastes delicious. I'm a fan. Yeah. And then we sent you a pint of milk, but we only need one cup for this recipe today, right? A pint of milk is just easier to ship. But if you guys have a one cup measuring cup, go ahead and grab that. And if you have a liquid cup too, that'll work too. If you want to eye it out, you also can eye that milk out. I'm someone who likes to do precise measuring, so go ahead and grab that one cup if you're like me, okay? But eyeing it out is usually how you can do most recipes anyways. Awesome. There we go. Yeah. We're measuring it out as we speak over at the Wagner's. Beautiful. And then to sort of help separate in the very classic Philadelphia way, if you have a metal spatula, go ahead and grab that. Not necessary. If you want to use just your wooden spoon to separate your filling, either one works, okay? But I like the metal spoon just because it has the nice edges here, so it helps me sort of portion out the filling per sandwich. But if you don't have one, don't worry about it. Not a big deal. And of course, it would not be a cheesesteak without cheese. So grab yourself a box grater or a microplane, something to get your cheese smaller than the original. Oh my god, the Wagner's have already grated that beautiful Tillamook cheddar. Nicely done, chefs. And then I never cook without my handy dandy pepper mill. Okay, so if you have a pepper mill, grab that. Or if you already have pre-ground pepper, that'll work too. We're gonna need about a little half teaspoon. Oh, the Wagner's have the one where you, is this the one where you pop it, that you click it? The click ones are dope. Yeah, I love those. Those are awesome. So go ahead and grab your favorite pepper mill. I like to use the largest pepper mill I could find. Yeah. Kathleen, nice pepper mill, beautiful. And then we're just gonna need two medium-sized mixing bowls, okay? Plastic, ceramic, metal, doesn't really matter. We just need two medium-sized, just so we can mix some stuff once they start cooking. All right, that's all the equipment. Thumbs up, everyone feeling good, right? Pretty standard stuff, nothing out of the ordinary, incredible. Let's start talking about these awesome ingredients. And so what we have here are two gorgeous steak rolls, right? We're making two Philly cheese sandwiches here. And Philly cheese, or California cheesesteak, I guess, technically, but a cheesesteak sandwich should have a minimum of a half pound of meat per sandwich. And so we have 1 pound of deliciously sliced ribeye, okay? I'm keeping it in the package for now. And if you're looking at it, you kind of notice that there's these beautiful slices. And so our meat purveyor here uses some gorgeous Midwest Angus beef, and they have sliced this meat for this class specifically, okay? If you ever want to get this sort of sliced meat, a really great little trick is if you go to your local Asian market and you ask for shabu-shabu meat, they will slice ribeye for you like this, right? Or if you ask your local butcher, say, hey, can I get about 25 centimeter slices of ribeye, they will do it for you. And so if you guys ever want to recreate this dish, what they do is they slightly freeze it, slightly, not totally frozen, and then they slice it on a meat slicer and it's ready to go. But for this recipe, we hooked it up for you. Some really good stuff. Super stoked to use ribeye. One of my favorite cuts on the cow. Awesome. Of course, my East Coast friends may or may not agree with me, but Utz are a classic accoutrement to this. So these are actually from and born and raised Philadelphia from the 1870s, I think. This is a very, very old company. But if you ever lived on the East Coast, in any bodega, you'll find these all over the place. So we're gonna serve that with our sandwiches. And we have those two beautiful buns here from Wertemeyer here in Oakland. We have a little bit of milk for our cheese sauce. We have a little bit of that Tillamook cheddar for our cheese sauce. And then to bind all of our cheesy dairy goodness, this is a little packet here called cheese sauce seasoning. And what is in here is a base of cornstarch, onion powder, garlic powder, mustard powder, paprika, a whole lot of love. But the main factor to this cheese sauce is that cornstarch. That natural starch that you get from corn is gonna keep our cheese sauce together, and it's also gonna thicken up in a really nice natural way, okay? If you guys ever wanna recreate that cheese sauce, on the back of that cheesesteak recipe card, it has those ratios for you. So very, very easy to make, and we hook that recipe up on that card as well. And then for some health, we got some vegetables, right? We got some mushrooms, we got an onion, right? Health, health, health. And then to make our cheese sauce more luscious, we're gonna use Philadelphia cream cheese. That's right, Diane knows Philadelphia cream cheese is where it's at. So we'll add that to add a little bit of depth to our cheese sauce. And traditionally, right, you'll usually make your cheesesteak with some onions and peppers. But instead of just using a regular old bell pepper, I am gonna ask that we use a little bit of pepperoncini. Pickled peppers, there's salt, there's acid to that liquid. And so not only will we use the peppers themselves that have been pickled, but we will also use the liquid that they're held in. Awesome. All right, so we have our equipment, we have our ingredients. So if you guys are ready to get chopping and get ready to get cooking, let's see some thumbs up. You guys ready to rock? Yes, amazing. All right, so go ahead and if you haven't already, turn your oven to 350 degrees, okay? And we're gonna go ahead and toast our beautiful pieces of bread on a sheet tray. So go ahead and grab that sheet tray, but we're not gonna toast these buns until we're just there, okay? So go ahead and just preheat your ovens to 350. If you've already done that, way to go. And so while we're waiting for our ovens to get hot, and we're gonna toast those buns, they're only gonna take about 5 minutes. So we'll do that at the very, very end once our filling's ready to go. We're gonna go ahead and start rocking out this prep. And so what I'm gonna do is grab the hardest part, that onion, okay? So grab that onion and we're gonna slice this onion up. And so whenever you are cutting an onion, it's a super good idea to identify the root. All right, there's that root, that hard, hairy part. And then go ahead and find that little tail. Find that tail, and keeping your fingertips nice and curled, just trim off that tail. What you'll get are those layers exposed, and you're also gonna give yourself a really nice flat part of that onion. This is great for stock, but for this recipe, we're just gonna go ahead and compost that baby. And so now that the root is nice and stable, I'm gonna go ahead and just cut that root right down the center, easy. So now I have two onion rainbows with a little bit of that skin and a little bit of that root holding it together. So peeling out that first layer, and sometimes that first layer of onion as well, right? If it's a little bit fibrous, go ahead and remove that skin. And what you'll get are two very solid halves of onion. These would be also amazing for stock, but we're gonna go ahead and compost for today. And then I'm gonna make myself some really nice slices. And so since I've left a little piece of that root on there, my layers are being held together. And so what I'll do is keeping my fingertips nice and curled, I'm gonna make little slices going from the end of the onion to the root. And because that root is holding all of my layers together, as I slice the onion, that onion stays nice and stable. And what I'll get are these really nice, about 16ths of an inch slices. And the reason you wanna keep your onion slices as even as possible is so that they cook evenly, right? If you have a thick piece compared to a skinny piece, they just cook differently. And so that's the real reason why chefs have great knife skills. It's just so their vegetables cook properly. A little trick, when you get to the skinny part and it starts to wobble, turn it 90 degrees. And as long as your onion is the same size all the way across, don't worry too much about that perfect half moon shape. And because you've turned it 90 degrees a few times, the only thing you waste is a little bit of onion. I'm gonna go ahead and do that with the second half as well. And I'm sort of slicing across that onion, right? I'm just slicing across, keeping my fingertips nice and curled. Once I get to a skinny part, 90 degrees and 90 degrees. No waste. Nothing has been wasted. Easy money. Awesome. And so we're gonna caramelize these onions. And so what I like to do is I get myself a big old plate and I get all of my cut vegetables on the same plate just so I don't have multiple dishes to do later. But I just make sure everything is nice and separated. All right, once you have sliced your onions to perfection, pop them onto a large plate or bowl or whatever you choose to do. And DJ Joey Z loves to see those knife skills. So hold those onions up and try to hold them away from your eyes so you don't cry too much. All right? And just show off those knife skills. Let's see how this warm-up went. Yes, chef. Yes, chef.
Happy. Look at those knife skills. Yes, chef. Yes, Diane. Woo!
Yes, chef. Mountain of onions.
Chef Jasmine, the tears are coming. They're fighting your way. Okay,
they're worth it every time, I promise. There we go. Perfect.
Oh, all right.
You gotta let the beat drop. All right. So we have our onions ready to go. And so we're gonna add a little bit more vegetation to this, and we're gonna go ahead and grab that beautiful quarter pound of cremini mushrooms. And so depending on what size mushrooms you got, you may have about 6 to 8. And these mushrooms have already been cleaned, and mushrooms are a little bit like sponges, okay? And so instead of taking them underneath your sink and rinsing them like you would any other vegetable, what I would love to suggest is that you take a paper towel, you moisten that paper towel slightly with water, and then just rub the outside of those mushrooms with a little bit of that paper towel. And so you can see all the dirt gets removed from the top of that mushroom cap and remains on your paper towel. And so take a few minutes here, just rub off any dirt that may have been added to that mushroom. But usually when mushroom farmers remove the cremini's from the ground, right? Cremini's or any mushrooms are spores that grow out of the ground. And so any of this dirt is just from the packaging. And so you just want to sort of wipe it away. It's not bacteria, it's all good. And so you can see how much dirt just gets removed, right? That is a dirty piece of paper towel right there. Because if you were to sort of soak these in water, the sponginess would sort of ruin them. And that water would sort of retain within those mushroom walls, and they would take a lot longer to caramelize. Okay? So take a second, clean off, wipe off all those beautiful mushrooms. And what we're gonna do, just like our onions, we're gonna slice these. But I like to keep the stem because the stems have some great flavor. And so what I do is I just sort of hold that mushroom on its side. And then just like I did with that onion, keeping my fingertips nice and curled, I'm just gonna slice across. It gets some really nice 16th of an inch slices of mushroom. So I'm just holding it down. Once I get to a part of that mushroom where it's a little too skinny to handle, turn it 90 degrees, make it flat. As long as all of these slices are the same in width, they will cook together. And mushrooms are the first vegetable that I learned to cut quickly because they're really nice and soft, and you can really work on that fast slice. And so if you ever want to get quick at cutting your mushrooms, right, what you're doing is on the side, you're slicing forward. And because mushrooms are really nice and gentle, you can really get that rolling motion, right? All the way across. Awesome. And so we're just getting these nice and thin, just like the onions, right? Same size as the onion. And we're using that stem, right? This is 100% edible. And so we don't want to accidentally cut anything unnecessarily. Sometimes people will tell you to remove the stem, but I think stems of most things have a lot of delicious flavor. All right, so we're just slicing across, yum. And then what I'm gonna do is just get those beautiful mushrooms and land them right next to my onion, but I'm gonna keep them nice and separated. The Wagners are asking me a pretty fun question. What is the brand of your knife? And so this brand is actually a Takayuki. That is T-A-K-A-Y-U-K-I. Joey is so sweet and is popping that into the chat. One of my favorite online knife sort of stores is MTC Kitchen. And they have this amazing hookup. It's a restaurant company that I introduced myself to in New York City, and they work really closely with Japanese family-owned knife makers. What's really cool about Japanese knives is that a majority of them are descendants of samurai knives. So they know how to make steel to where they are literally indestructible, okay? And so buying and investing in a Japanese knife is incredible. But I will say, if you take care of your knife, whether it's German, American, Japanese, any other brand, as long as you take care of your knife and treat it like an investment, right? Just like you would with a cast iron pan, you can do anything with it. But I am a big fan of Japanese steel just because they pass that knowledge on from generation to generation. And if you ever want to check out their website, they have a lot of really cool history about different Japanese families who have kind of descended themselves and made sure that they kept that culture of the same sort of steel multiple times, last you a lifetime. And so check it out. But hopefully you can find something like that. I know, I'm nerding out a lot. Oh my gosh, Mondays, all about the nerds. Amazing. So we have our onion sliced. We have our mushroom sliced. And so let's keep going on. And we're going to go ahead and give ourselves a little snack. So go ahead and grab that cheese. Just go ahead and grab that cheese real quick. We're gonna take a minute from the knife skills. Grab that beautiful Tillamook cheddar. Open that beautiful baby up. And we're gonna use all the cheese. All this cheese is being used today. And so I'm gonna go ahead and open up that package. And if you've already sliced that cheese, or sorry, shredded that cheese, go ahead, take a minute, pour yourself another beverage. But I'm gonna go ahead and take that entire piece of cheddar. And if you're using a box grater, find your biggest hole. And we're using all of it today. That's right. We're going to use all this cheese. But the best part about this cheese whiz that we're going to make is that we're going to not use all of it, but you can store it. And because it's stabilized with cornstarch, it's going to stay very, very spreadable. So you can spread it on your cheese in the morning. You can pop it on your nachos if you guys want to make nachos, okay? And so whatever you want to do, you can use this for another day. And so once we make this cheese sauce, you can microwave it, you can just add it to your pan to warm up again, but we're going to use that entire packet of cheese. Once you shred that cheese, go ahead, take a pinch, and give yourself a little cheese bite. Joey Z, would you like a cheese bite? There you go, Joey Z. Here we go. Cheese bite.
Thank you so much.
If you take a cheddar cheese bite and you chase it with that Paloma, match made in heaven. Also, please stay hydrated, my chefs. As chefs, you know how important it is. Oh my God, Jacqueline sharing with her beautiful partner. Ah. That's love right there. That's straight up love. That's what I like to see out there, chefs. Nicely done. Go ahead and get that out of your board and onto a small plate or bowl. And you might be thinking to yourself, man, that's a lot of cheese. But once you use it all, you go, man, I need more cheese. That's how I always feel. When I was writing this recipe, I'm like, am I going to use the whole block? And I said, yeah. I'm gonna use the whole block. Of course I am. Come on now. All right. So cheese is shredded, ready to rock. We need to cut a few more things here. And so the last thing that we are going to cut now are those beautiful pepperoncinis. And so you may have noticed that we have stored the pepperoncinis in their pickling liquid, in their pickling brine, which has a lot of salt and acid. And so we're actually gonna use this liquid as part of our cooking process. And so what I like to do is grab a nice little small bowl. I open up that container of pepperoncinis, and using that lid, I'm gonna strain out that liquid and save as much of that liquid as I can here. And then now that these are nice and strained, I'm going to remove these peppers out of that container onto my board. So not only am I straining these, but now I have all this beautiful liquid, about a quarter cup of liquid left for our sauce. So pickling liquid on the side. And because pepperoncinis, right, these beautiful Greek peppers have been brined and pickled and stored, they're very tender. So first thing we're gonna do is grab any stem and just remove any stem from these peppers. A little seed is not a big deal, right? These seeds in these peppers are nice and pickled, so they're nice and tender. But what I wanna remove is that fibrous stem on the top. So I just need to pull it out. It's gonna be a little juicy, but that's all right. That's all acid, that's all salt, that's all love. And so now we just have this very edible pile of peppers here. And any of these stems, I'm gonna go ahead and compost, right? These are just a little bit too tough to eat off of. And you've noticed that everything we've cut today has been nice and long. And so how do you take something that's nice and stout, right? This is a little bit of a skinnier guy, and make it elongated. So what I'm gonna do, and what you can do with any sort of pepper or carrot or anything that has a skinny body to it, is you're gonna go ahead and cut this piece of vegetable on a bias. Whenever you cut anything on a bias, you're gonna go one piece at a time and make an acute triangle with your knife and the product, okay? So you see I have a kind of an angle here, and I'm starting from the edge of that product, and I'm gonna slice forward on that angle, right? An acute triangle is less than 90 degrees. We're going back to our geometry days here. And because I'm cutting that pepper on that bias, what I'm gonna get are these really nice long pieces of cut pepper. And so cutting on a bias, especially with something that's a little waxy like this, keep those fingertips nice and tight and slice across, right? Really utilize the length of that blade, slice across, and it's gonna be a little juicy, but all this juice is gonna add flavor to our Philly cheesesteak filling. So it's all good stuff. So whenever I'm cutting a big pile of something, I always put that pile on the side of my non-cutting hand, right? So I'm left-handed here, so I have everything on the right side of my board. I think I just squirted you, Joey. I'm so sorry. Yeah. Sometimes you get a squirt.
It's refreshing. It's so hot out.
And so you just got to keep on. Wow, that was amazing. And so sometimes you shoot a little pickling juice out your corner. But because you have all of this beautiful, elongated slices of pepperoncini, we're actually going to use these pepperoncinis in two ways, okay? So once you have all that pepperoncini sliced up, you're going to save half of it to add to the top of your cheesesteak, and you're going to put half of it into the filling. And so what I'll do is I'll take half of it, and I'll keep it nice and just straight up pickled. And the other half, I'll pop right onto that plate with my mushrooms, my onions, and now adding that pepperoncini. Making sure everything is nice and separated. Okay, nice and separated. Any liquid that's left from your board, using the back of your knife, go ahead and slide that liquid right onto those peppers, right? Save all that flavor. That's good stuff right there. Yum. Using pickling juice as acid to your recipe is a great way to add a little bit of depth to the flavor. All right, so we have our pepperoncini sliced, mushroom sliced, ready to go. And we've separated these. And now we're looking like a beautiful rainbow across the board. And so once you have all your knife skills right, go ahead and show them off. Either hold them up or tilt your cameras down. Joey Z loves to see knife skills once they're done and in our rear view mirror.
Jacqueline's showing us the moves.
There we go.
That's the beat with my boss. Yes,
if you dance with your cheese, it tastes better. That's right.
Diana's getting it all cut up. Yes, chef. Woo! Look at that.
Oh, who's ready for a picture?
Just Kathleen, how's it going, Chad? Crushing it.
Yes, chefs. You nailed it. All right, so our cutting portion of the class, gone. goodbye in the rearview mirror. You guys are crushing this recipe out. But I would love to do a quick vibe check. How's everyone feeling? Give me a thumbs up if you're having a good time. Thumbs up all around. Yes! That's really what matters. As long as you're having fun, I'm having fun. Excellent. All right, so all these beautiful ingredients are sliced, separated, ready to go. And so we're going to make ourselves a cheese sauce, because once we start making the cheese sauce, we're going to need to let it hang out for a minute just so that all those flavors can mingle and then that cheese can fully melt, okay? And so I'm just going to walk us through the cheese sauce, because once we start cooking, it's sort of just like a bam, 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 okay? So if you want to take a minute, sort of remove your camera so it's closer to the stove, that's always a great idea. And I'm just going to talk us through it, okay? Whenever you are making a cheese sauce, and you may have done this with us if you made our mac and cheese recipe, is that once you add dairy to any hot liquid, there is a chance that it can break. And so what you want to do is to get your liquid as hot as possible on the heat. And then once you're ready to add your cheese, the heat is off, okay? And you let that residual warmth melt the cheese, but you never want your cheese sauce to boil once the cheese is in. Because if cheese boils, the sauce may separate, okay? So what we're gonna do is we're gonna take 1 cup of milk and bring it up to a simmer, okay? A simmer is not quite a boil, but it is a almost boil, okay? And we're going to add the cheese seasoning mix, because starch will only activate in a sauce if it comes up to a certain temperature. So what we're gonna do is allow the milk and our starch to get nice and hot. Once both of those things are nice and hot, then we'll turn the heat off, add our cheese and our cream cheese, put the lid on, season it with truffle salt, and then we'll let it melt, okay? Give me a thumbs up if that makes sense. Does everyone feel good about that? Awesome, okay, let's groove, let's do it. So go ahead, grab that milk and that 1 cup measuring device and pour in your beautiful small sauce pot 1 cup of milk. Or if you want to eye it, it's half of this container, right? This is 2 cups, so it's half. And what we're going to do is turn this on nice and medium to medium high, depending on your heat source. So I'm going nice and medium. And I'm just gonna let this come up to a nice simmer, okay? While this is coming up to a simmer, I'm gonna go ahead and equip myself, all right? I'm gonna equip myself with my whisk, and I'm gonna open up that seasoning packet, which is cornstarch and delicious flavors, okay? But I'm not gonna put it in quite yet, okay? I'm gonna wait till this comes up to a simmer. Because we're only heating up a cup of liquid, this is gonna come up to a simmer pretty quickly, okay? It's not gonna be too far, it's not gonna take too long. And we have that nice medium heat, right? We have that nice medium to medium high heat, depending on your heat source. And what we're gonna do is just really wait until we start to see some steam, okay? Once we start to see a little bit of steam, not boiling or not simmering, but just a little bit of steam coming off of your milk, which should be pretty quickly, right? What you're gonna do with a whisk in one hand and that seasoning packet in the other, you're gonna sprinkle and whisk. Sprinkle and whisk. Yeehaw! And we're still on medium to medium high. The second that seasoning hits that warm liquid, it's gonna start to smell really good. You're gonna smell mustard, onion, garlic, paprika. So now that I've added this, and I'm still on that medium to medium high heat, right? Now what I'm doing is allowing the cornstarch and those seasonings to come up with that milk, okay? And this is just a really nice way to make a very quick cheese whiz that's nice and stable, right? That cornstarch is nice and stable. All right, so still on that medium heat. I'm starting to see some action here. Not quite boiling, but a good simmer, okay? Good simmer here. And When this sauce comes up to a simmer and you see a little bit of boiling, and you're gonna notice that the liquid, that milk, thickens up slightly. That's as far as you need to go. That's it. But to ensure that this sauce and the cheese melts, you have to bring this liquid and cornstarch up to a simmer. You need to see a little bit of action in there, okay? So if you're a little bit behind me, take your time. Let it come up to a simmer, no big deal. Once that simmer is alive and well, all you need to do is turn the heat off. Once you turn the heat off, you're gonna take all that cheddar cheese, boom, all in, baby. And because you got your milk hot enough to melt that cheese is just gonna do its thing. It's gonna melt right in. And you are off the heat. The second that cheese goes in, the heat is no longer on. And so it's super important that you get that milk and cornstarch warm enough so that your cheese can actually melt. And so now my heat is off. I'm just whisking in that cheese. And if you have a little bit of texture, right? If some things aren't quite melting, don't worry. We're gonna put that lid on it and it's gonna keep on melting. All right, so once all that cheddar's in there, don't forget about that cream cheese, okay? So once the cheddar is pretty much melted, still off the heat, right? Heat is off. The second you add dairy, heat must be off. Go ahead and grab that beautiful container of cream cheese. And cream cheese is very easy to spread, right? We've whipped this for you. So either grabbing a spoon or a spatula, slide in that cream cheese. And that cream cheese is not only going to thicken up our sauce, but it's also going to grab some really amazing texture.
Oh yeah,
I love cream cheese. If you need to lick this spoon of cream cheese, I totally get it. I do it all the time. And so cream cheese goes in, still off the heat here, and you're just gonna let that residual heat, and you'll see, because cream cheese is kind of a spread, right? It's basically a cultured dairy. You just, you know, whisk it in. That's it. It'll mesh right in. Off that heat, using that whisk. And voila. So, quick recap. We brought our milk. We brought our milk and our cornstarch to a simmer. Once that simmer was alive and well, off the heat, we added all of the cheddar and all of the cream cheese. But you may have noticed that we need a little bit of seasoning, okay? And we do call this truffle whiz. So how do we truffle that whiz? Well, we conveniently have that Bolognese truffle salt, which has multiple flavors of Bolognese truffle salt here. And so once you have all of your dairy in, take that plate that you use for your cocktail, and you're gonna give yourself a solid chef pinch. Whenever you give yourself a chef pinch of anything, it's when you take all five fingers, you take a pinch of that Bolognese truffle salt, and from as high as you possibly can, you're gonna season and truffle up that cheese sauce and make it rain, baby. Make it rain.
Making it rain. Chef Jacqueline showing us how it's done.
There you go, Chef.
Oh, the Wagners, look at that. Rain down.
Rushing
it.
Yeah, all right. So here's where the best part. We're gonna have to taste this cheese sauce. I know. The sacrifices we make as chefs. We're gonna have to taste it. But instead of just taking a spoon, right? Instead of taking a spoon and tasting it, here's what I like to suggest. Go ahead and open up that Utz bag, okay? One of the Utz bags. Open it up, and instead of using a spoon to taste this cheese sauce, use a potato chip. My dad likes to call this a putacho, okay? That's a potato nacho. Dip that potato chip in that cheese whiz and hold it up, okay? I want to see how everybody's cheese sauce is looking. Come on over to the camera, the Wagners. Come on over here, chef. There we go. Look at that consistency. Diane, yes. Cheers, you guys, and give it a taste. Yes. Magic. Absolute magic. That's the fastest cheese whiz you'll ever make in the culinary world. I hope so. I hope so. All right, so when you're tasting it, you want to keep this cheese sauce warm, right? Because after the cheese has been added, we can boil it. So either using your lid or plate, just lid that cheese sauce and put it to the side. Just put it to the side. It will stay nice and warm in this pan, I promise, okay? Just keep that lid on there. Keep it to the side. Easy. If at any point during this class you need to take another potato chip and test it again, I won't get mad at you. I totally get it, okay? It is all about snacking, especially in your own kitchen.
Yeah.
Awesome. All right, give me a thumbs up. How is everybody's cheese whiz? Everyone feeling good about it? Success? Awesome. Oh, so good. Use this sauce for nachos, chili cheese dogs, quesadillas, Crunchwrap Supremes, whatever you guys want to use at your house is a great baseline. And you have that recipe on that recipe card, okay? Awesome. All right. So now that our cheese sauce is to the side here, we're going to start working on our filling. But a new thing that we're doing here at Truffle Shuffle is we're going to do a quick commercial break. I know, we've never done it before. We're adding it to it. It's like, I feel like, I know, quick commercial break. But not only is this a commercial break, but it is time for you guys to refill your beverages. It's a refill break, if you will. My beverage is kind of low, so I'm going to go ahead. I know, the Wagners are like, how dare you? So I need to refill my beverage. Yeah, I know. So take a minute. Check out what we're going to do for next Sunday's class. We'll be right back with you guys in 1 minute, I promise. That's it. That was our commercial. How did we do? It's only 30 seconds. I know. Yeah, I know, right? So sweet and simple, sweet and simple. Join us for our birthday bash. It's going to be awesome. Tuck is turning 22. She was like, I'm turning 22. I know. She's so young. And so she wants you to join us for her birthday bash. So let us know if you guys want to go. But back to the matter at hand. Let's start talking about this filling. Oh, yes. I didn't even, this is a jam. Joey Z's feeling good about this. And so we're gonna start making our filling here. And so when you are looking at that beautiful little container of canola oil, we're gonna use this in three different parts, okay? So when you're looking at that canola oil, consider it to be three different parts. Oh my God, Diane, are you making palomas right now? With grapefruit and lemon juice? Can you? I just saw a bottle of grapefruit and I was like, yes, yes. Diane, you're a rock star. Love that. We're making a big batch of Paloma for a Monday. Amazing. All right, so look at your little container of canola and you want to look at it in three parts, okay?
Yes. Yes.
Diane, that's so awesome. That's so awesome that he just came back with a jug of grapefruit juice and lemon juice. I am so impressed. Ah, I love my job. I love my job. I love you guys. Love my job. Okay, so look at your canola oil and take the first third and go ahead and pop it into your cast iron pan or whatever you chose to use, okay? So we're going to use this canola oil in three parts. So take that first third, Or if you really want to be nerdy about it, it's about 2 tablespoons, right? There's about 6 tablespoons in this container. So take that first 2 tablespoons, pop it into whatever saute pan you chose to use today, and then go ahead and turn it on nice and high. If you have a hood system, now is the time to turn that baby on. Okay, we're gonna get smoky. We're gonna get smoky in here. Awesome. And so what we're gonna do is caramelize onion in a specific way. There are 2 ways to caramelize onion. One is low and slow, where you stew your onions. But for this recipe, we want texture, right? We want texture in our sandwich. So 2 ways to caramelize onion is either low and slow, which we're not gonna do, or high and fast, which is what we are gonna do. And so if you've ever gone to Gino's or Pat's or any Philly cheesesteak place, you notice that they cook it on a griddle, hot and fast. And the reason they do that is so that our onions will caramelize, but they will not lose that crunchy texture. And so the secret to high and fast caramelization of onion is you wanna wait until the oil gets to a smoking point, okay? And so once that 2 tablespoons is in your pan, move it around, right? Kind of rock it back and forth, make sure the coating is even on and in your pan. And once you start to see that the smoke is consistent, right? You can see, like, even when I moved it, right, there was a little bit of smoke, but once I moved around, the smoke went away. You want to make sure that as you move it around, that smoke is consistent. And you also just want to coat that beautiful pan evenly. And once you actually start to see the viscosity of your oil change, at first it was kind of thick like oil, but now as you sort of move your pan away, you'll notice that it's dense like water. That's another indicator that your oil has reached the proper temp. So let that oil get hot for a sec. Let it do its thing. Once you start to see that, you see how I have that constant smoking going around? That's where I wanna be, right there. Boom, I can see it, I can smell it. The first thing I'm gonna add to my pan are my onions, okay? So we're just onions right now, just onions. Slide those babies right in, easy. Using that wooden spoon, go ahead and move these around. And you wanna smell this sort of barbecue smell, right? This sort of charred onion flavor. And because you waited for your pan to get nice and hot, you're gonna get almost immediate color on your onions, right? That color is gonna come in pretty quickly. And I'm just gonna move around once in a while. And so the secret to fast caramelization is make sure that that pan is nice and hot. I'm already getting a little bit of color. Shake that pan, use that spoon, hot and fast. As long as you keep moving around, and as long as you have a little bit of oil, the water is gonna quickly evaporate, right? Because caramelization, the science behind it is, one, you're evaporating liquid, right? You're evaporating the natural water that is found in most vegetables. Once that water is gone, there is natural sugar in onions specifically and in most vegetables. So the color comes from you caramelizing the natural sugars. And so as long as you have the heat and you have that evaporation happening, that color and taste and flavor will come through, okay? So we're just hot and fast here. Keep moving it around. And 2 tablespoons is not a lot of oil, okay? So for this fast, hot caramelization, make sure you don't oversaturate your pan with oil. Just enough to coat the bottom. That's also gonna help you get that nice color as well.
Oh, yeah.
You can do this technique with anything, especially in the summer. Peppers, eggplant, squash, beans, whole beans, especially in the summer. You can do this same technique with fruit, peaches, nectarines. Char them on one side, very low amount of oil, just enough to coat the bottom of the pan so nothing sticks, and allow the natural sugars to do their thing. Best part about summer cookery, which is what we're in right now, is that everything uses its natural sugar to add more flavor. Awesome. All right. So, because you're cooking these onions hot and fast, you'll notice that they've become a little bit limper, a little more tender, which is exactly what we want for our sandwich. A nice crunch, but tender onion with some good flavor. All right. Once you have a little bit of color, and you're seeing that your onions are nice and limp, what you're gonna do is slide in those mushrooms, all right? Slide in those mushrooms. And you may be wondering, we haven't added any salt yet. And that's because we're waiting for our pickling liquid to be our seasoner, okay? So I just slid in those mushrooms, and now I'm letting the mushrooms evaporate on their liquid and to caramelize as well, okay? So it's all about staging your vegetables properly. So giving those onions a moment in that real contact with that heat. And now adding the mushrooms, and now the mushrooms are gonna extract some water, which is also gonna help cook those mushrooms as well, and those onions to be tender. So now I have mushrooms and onions doing their thing. A great chef technique is, as you are cooking everything, make sure you're taking a sip of that cocktail. Diane, how does that homemade cocktail taste? Is it pretty good?
Oh, yeah.
Yes, chef!
The Wagner's got the cooperation.
The Wagner's got the white wine.
Kathleen,
the spritz.
Yes.
Cheers, y'all. Stay hydrated. It's a Monday after all. Yes. Oh, we got some gorgeous wine going on at the Wagner's.
Woo!
Yes, chef. Yes, chef. All right. So onions are in. Color. Mushrooms are in. Sauteed. So we want to let the onions and the mushrooms do their thing for a minute, because once we add the peppers, we want to keep in mind that the peppers are already pickled, okay? So once you add half of those sliced pepperoncinis, right, because we save the other half for later, just let those saute for a few seconds here. Saute them for a few seconds. And then here's where the magic happens, okay? So once you have onions, mushrooms, half of those sliced pepperoncinis, take that pickling liquid that you saved earlier and deglaze, okay? Deglaze. All of it, all of that pickling liquid is going in. Woo! Flavor! Make sure those hood systems are on, baby. Let all that cook for a second. Yum! So Wagner's, we just added the pickling liquid once we added half of the peppers. So go, yeah, right in with there, yeah. So when you add this half of the sliced pepperoncinis, you save the other half for later. Pickling liquid goes right in. And we're doing all that pickling liquid. And you can see I have a pretty juicy situation here. But I'm gonna cook this down until I have what I call au sec. Au sec means almost dry. So you can see I have all this liquid here, but I'm gonna cook this down until the liquid clings onto the vegetable part of my filling. The reason we're deglazing with this pickling liquid is because pickling liquid not only has salt, it has sugar, and it has fermentation. Fermentation, just like soy sauce, is what we like to refer to as umami, right? Umami is that flavor that you can't stop eating, that addictive flavor. Umami is that flavor profile that we just can't stop loving. So using pickling liquid like this and seasoning our vegetables is not only utilizing what would have gone down the drain, but it's also creating a little fermentation of flavor. There we go. Yeah, Wagner is saying grapes fermentation. Heard of it? Love it. Yeah. Amazing. You know exactly what I'm talking about. Awesome. And so once you see no more liquid, but your mixture is moist. I hate to use that word, but moist is the word we're looking for. I know, it sounds really silly, but moist. Moist text, yeah. That's as far as we need to go, okay? Once you see that, turn your heat off for a second. And we're gonna go ahead and just taste our vegetables here, okay? So I'm gonna just take a little spoon. And being very careful, because this mixture is hot, right? Get a little bit of pepperoncini, a little bit of mushroom, a little bit of onion. Just a little bite. Give it the old mama blow. Remember, everything you cook is hot. I learned this the hard way. I'm the kind of person that will fry something and immediately eat it and then burn my mouth before dinner. It's the worst. So, blow on it.
Oh, yeah.
So we haven't added any salt to this, but there's gonna be some heat from the pepperoncini, right? Oh my gosh, we got some thumbs up from the Wagners. If you feel like it needs some more seasoning, no problem. That is what that Bolognese truffle salt is for. But if you feel like it's perfect exactly where it is, keep it right there, okay? So taste it. That is the most important lesson as a chef. Taste as you go, okay? And then when you taste, make sure you cleanse your palate with a little bit of that cocktail, okay? Make sure you're cleansing your palate. Our professionals, okay? Cleanse our palate. And so we need the space to cook our meat. So what I'm gonna do is grab my first medium-sized mixing bowl, and then I'm just gonna go ahead and remove these vegetables into that medium-sized mixing bowl, okay? Just to get it out of the way, but to also keep these vegetables nice and warm. So a medium-sized mixing bowl or any bowl you feel like is appropriate to fit that in. And your cast iron pan or whatever large saute pan doesn't need to be fully clean, right? All this flavor is good. That's literally how they do it in Philly cheesesteak places, is they actually just keep everything together. So if it's not completely clean, don't worry about it. It's just all part of the layers of flavor. All right, once you have your mushroom, onion, pepperoncini, deglaze mixture, go ahead and hold it up to the camera. I wanna see how everyone's caramelization turned out. Joey Z wants to see how we doing out there.
Jacqueline, look at that. Woo! Oh, Diana's literally steaming.
She's so hot right now.
Wagner's
caramelization for days, chef. Yes. J-Lo would be so impressed right now. Ah, love it. Awesome. All right, chefs. So, no big deal, but what have you done today? One, you have been awesome, generally. You've made yourself a cocktail, you've caramelized vegetables to perfection, and you've made cheese whiz. But let's get meaty. Thumbs up if you're ready to get meaty. Who's ready to get meaty out there? Yes! All right, grab that second medium-sized mixing bowl and grab that beautiful package of sliced ribeye, okay? Because this sliced ribeye is not gonna have too much juice, go ahead and just remove the meat out of the package into the bowl, okay? There's not gonna be too much juice, right? We don't need to worry about it getting too liquidy. As you remove it out of the bag, you're gonna see those beautiful slices. And we're gonna take another third of that canola oil and add it to our meat, okay? So there should be one third left. Put that to the side. And the reason we're adding oil to this now is so that the oil can sort of seep into all of the slices, okay? But before we get our hands too meaty, we're gonna go ahead and add a little bit of that Bolognese truffle salt, okay? So five fingers here. We're gonna do two pinches, because there is two portions, right? So come on over here. If you feel like you're a little sensitive to spice, start with one. You can always add more, okay? But for me, I like to do one from as high as I possibly can. Yes, yeah, Jacqueline, you know. Okay, so one and two. Make it rain one more time, baby. Boom. Yeah. Don't forget about that black pepper, okay? Give me a strong amount of black pepper. If you are sensitive to spice, go about, I don't know, a teaspoon. But if you like black pepper like I do, make it rain, baby. Make it rain, okay? So totally up to you. I love black pepper, so I go nuts. That's a just honesty right there. I go nuts for black pepper. But if you feel like, you know what, I'm not the biggest black pepper person, maybe go a little less. Okay, no big deal. All right, now what we're gonna do, there we go. Yes, the Wagner is over here. Pop, pop, yeah, pop, pop it. Yeah, yeah, pop, pop. Yes, amazing. Get that black pepper in there. Shit. And so come on, take your two hands here and we're gonna get weird, okay? We're gonna get in there and we're gonna massage this out. As you start to get your hands in there, you're gonna see those slices. There's gonna be some weirdness. There's gonna be some fat. There's gonna be some meat. But all you need to do is come up from behind and try and separate those slices, okay? Don't worry if they're not perfect slices. It's all good. This is ribeye. No matter what we do, this is going to be tender. So just get that coating of oil, that coating of salt. And because we sort of have this packet out, it's nice and tempered. All right. So we've added that oil to give us a little bit of coating to make sure that our salt and pepper have been evenly dispersed. So whenever you are coating anything, remember, fat is your friend, especially when you're trying to coat seasoning onto a product, whether it's protein, vegetables, tofu, whatever, right? Oil is your friend. You can definitely oversaturate something, but as long as you are just using it as much oil as you need, right? 2 tablespoons is nothing. But 2 tablespoons goes a long way, okay? So kind of keep that in mind whenever you kind of use this technique in the future. Awesome. All right, so once you have meated yourself, once you've Monday meated yourself, go ahead, you can take a minute, wash your hands, because we'll use the side of the bowl, right? We no longer have to touch that raw meat. So go ahead, wash those hands out. And there is gonna be one final third of oil. And what we'll do is we'll pop it into that pan with all of this onion, mushroom, pepperoncini flavor that we've left behind, okay? Cooking in one pan like this is an art, because what you're doing is you're developing flavor. So now the meat is gonna cook in this gorgeous, gorgeous flavor. Awesome. Once you have your meat seasoned with salt and pepper, and that remaining oil in the pan, turn that pan on nice and high, okay? But before we start cooking our meat, let's not forget about our buns, okay? So once you are waiting for your oil to get smoking hot again, grab that cheese tray that you grabbed earlier and your buns, and get those buns onto that cheese tray, and make sure, I never trust bun makers, make sure they're pre-cut. All right, make sure they're pre-cut. Sometimes they say they're pre-cut, sometimes they don't. I trust no one, friend. Make sure they're pre-cut. Put those buns on a sheet tray. And then do me and Joey Z a favor. Show us your buns. We want to see your buns. Show us your buns. Yeah, Chef Jacqueline. Nice buns, Chef.
Cut
and make sure they're open,
Wagner.
Baby.
Look at those buns.
Nice bun, Wagners.
Oh, there we go, Kathleen.
Woo! Yes, Chef Kathleen. Make sure they're open, baby. Boom. All right, pop them in the oven. There we go. Yes, Chef Wagners. Pop them in the oven. Excellent. Nice buns, everyone. And DJ Joey B is going to hook us up with a 5-minute timer. Okay, we just need to. We're not trying to toast these. We're just trying to warm them up so we have a little bit of texture. And because we're keeping them whole, they're going to be really nice and soft in the center. Right? All right. So now that we've gotten our buns in the oven, our pans are nice and hot, right? Pans are nice and hot. And so using the side of your bowl, go ahead and slide that meat right into that cast iron pan. Ooh, la la. Yum. Once that meat is in the pan, go ahead and just very gently make yourself a nice, even layer of meat. Okay, so either using your wooden spoon or your metal spatula, right, whatever feels comfortable, go ahead and just, keeping the meat on one side, let this become evenly distributed amongst the surface area of that pan, okay? And what we'll do, because we know that this meat is so thinly sliced, right? We're gonna let it caramelize on one side. That's it.
Oh yeah.
Let that sear off, baby. That's it. Evenly distributed. Let it sear off on one side. Using the side of your spoon. Let it sear, baby. Make sure those hood systems are on. There you go. Yum. Nice and high. Let it sear on one side.
Oh, Dr. Nuzzle's not just shut it down.
Yes, Chef Jacqueline. You better work, Boo. Yes, Mama. You want to see that before you even start to even attempt to mix it up. See that caramelization on one side. Just like you would with taco filling, let it caramelize on one side, okay? So if you're a little bit behind me, let it sear on that first side, because that's going to give you a lot of flavor. And then mix it up. All right, so you can see I'm mixing it up. Because this steak is so skinny, and because we know that ribeye is nice and tender, especially when it's cut this thin, we do not need to really test it temperature-wise. But what we do want to see is that rawness go away, okay? So once you start to see that red go away, and all you have left is that caramelization, that's all you need to do. I like to use the side of my spoon, break up those chunks, and that's it. So once we get that first initial side, all we're doing is mixing this up until we see no more rawness. That's it. You see that? So we let that first side caramelize. We let the rest of the meat cook through. Turn that heat right off. Easy peasy. And so what we have here is a delicious pan of meat and fat.
Oh yeah.
If you are sensitive to fatty foods, which I hate to admit, In my aging process, my stomach cannot handle as much meat fat as it used to.
Oh.
So if you're like me, Do not be afraid to remove this fat from this pan, okay? Before we get into that, our toasting timer just went off, okay? So grab that beautiful tray of buns, and all you're looking for is just warmth, okay? Just warmth. We're not trying to toast, because the secret to Philadelphia cheesesteak sandwiches is that you have a soft bread, but I like that toasty top. It's called contrast of texture, okay? Easy. And so go ahead and pull out your buns. And if you're like me, what I like to do is taking a glass jar, right? Glass jar is the best way to remove any fat. Go ahead and taking your spoon, tilt your pan to the side, and just get rid of any excessive beef fat. This is ribeye, okay? This is ribeye. So go ahead and remove any of that fat. If you like beef fat, like I do, you can keep that in. But you know what you can do with this excess of beef fat? You can make beef fat fries. You can make beef fat pâte choux. You can just drizzle this on anything you want. You can make a beef fat dressing, right? If you want to make like a bacon warm dressing with beef fat, go for it. This is real good stuff, okay? We don't need it for this recipe. So I'm just letting everyone know, if you're a little sensitive to fattier foods, remove it. You can see it's about a half cup. It's aggressive, but it also makes you realize that ribeye is delicious, okay? So save that. I would strongly urge you to cool it on your countertop before you put it away, okay? Awesome. So what's in here now is some gorgeous beef. And I'm gonna go ahead and separate this beef into two portions. If the person in your house is not a good portioner and likes to put too much on one side and not the other, make sure you guys are judging it together, okay? So split that meat in half. What? Me and Joey always fight about this. He's like, wow, my portion looks a lot smaller than yours. And I'm like, ah, sorry, Joey. So once you've portioned out that beef, okay, go ahead and take that caramelized veg that you did earlier and top it onto those portions of beef, okay? What we're gonna do is we're just gonna let that onion, mushroom, pepperoncini flavor coat the top of our meat. If you ever go to a Philly cheesesteak stand, they legitimately portion out meat just like this to make it easier to scoop into your sandwich. So I would do, if you portion out the meat in your sandwich will always be perfect, I promise. All right, so what we have here, quick recap, is meat cooked to perfection, portioned in half with our caramelized vegetables. We have our toasted, and our cheese sauce ready to rock. And so if you guys are ready to make some California cheesesteak sandwiches on a Monday, give me a thumbs up. Y'all ready? Y'all ready for this? Excellent. All right, let's construct. Sandwich construction is a big deal, okay? It's nothing to just, oh yeah, it's a sandwich. No, these are critical moments in our life, okay? A good sandwich is a good sandwich. A bad sandwich is a bad sandwich. We've all had bad sandwiches, okay? Let's be real. So, how I like to construct, yeah, see, the Wagners now, they're like 100%. So, let's go ahead and start talking about plating. What I like to do is I grab a plate for everybody. I open up those chips, and what you need for this sandwich is to unload the chip bag, right? There's two for each sandwich. And make yourself a little crevasse. Part the seas with that sandwich. Okay, part the seas with that sandwich. Or for that sandwich with those chips. So you see how that very even distribution right here? One in one. So get as many plates as you need. Make sure those chips are standing by. Then what you're gonna do is with your non-dominant hand, you're gonna grab one of those beautiful pieces of bread. And then either using your wooden spoon or that metal spatula, you're gonna go ahead and grab that filling and put it right into that sandwich. Like that. Ooh la la. If half of that filling doesn't fit, don't force it, okay? If you have about a third left, no big deal. It's just extra meat for your scramble in the morning, okay? Make sure there is a ratio that makes sense with this bread. And since you've constructed this positioning right here, land it between those two chips. Oh, look at that. Perfectly standing up. Ooh, la la. You can move it, you can dance with it. It's not going anywhere, okay? Look at it. Now that you have that filling with those chips ready to go, grab that ladle and that cheese sauce. Using the back of the ladle, give it a mix, right? Loosen it up. If your cheese sauce is insanely thick, that's what the rest of that milk is for, okay? But for me, this is looking pretty perfect. Oh, ho, ho. Looking pretty perfect, right?
Oh, yeah.
Go across with that ladle. Yum. That sandwich is going nowhere. Those chips are holding it down. Don't forget, you have the rest of those pepperoncinis to add not only a contrast of color, but a pop of acid, okay? Acid is the opponent to fat. So if you have something that's fatty, like ribeye and cheese sauce, this pop of acid from the pepperoncinis and the salt and vinegar chips is gonna bring everything together. If you are a salt hound like me, here's what you're gonna do. You're gonna take one last pinch of that Bolognese truffle salt and you're gonna sprinkle it onto the cheese sauce. Not only for color, but for texture. Here, my friends, is a California style Philly cheesesteak. Not only have you chopped it up, not only have you made cheese whiz, not only have we constructed a sandwich to perfection, but we have also caramelized onions. We have made ourselves a deglaze with pickling juice and made some delicious sliced ribeye filling. Okay. And so once you have a few sandwiches made up, do me a favor and hold that baby up. All right, hold this baby up. This is dinner, you guys. Happy Monday. Okay, I wanna see it all out. You're gonna have so much cheese sauce left over. Oh, Chef Jacqueline.
Chef Jacqueline, look at that.
The Wagners, let's see it.
Oh, oh the Wagners.
Yes, woo! Chef. Cheers, Chef.
Diane,
yes, Diane.
Chef waiting away out there.
Beautiful. Gorgeous. Oh my God. Amazing, you guys. Well, let me just take a quick second to say, I appreciate you guys so much. I appreciate y'all so much for taking your time on a beautiful day like Juneteenth. And it's very, very special to us to celebrate this day and to honor those that have made this specific day possible. And so thank you guys so much for taking the time just to hang out with us. And I hope those Philly cheesesteaks are awesome. They are, I'm gonna crush mine right now. I'm very excited. Joey Z, I'm sure, how do you feel? Are you stoked to meet these people? I am, that's for sure.
I'm not letting it leave this room.
All right, guys, happy Monday. Have a great rest of the week. We'll see you next time.